five decades, television has increasingly become America's primary news medium. As the times have changed and the technology has improved, what's become evident is the influence television has on shaping America's opinion. Over the years, some people and their ideas have been made powerful by television, while others have been ruined. It all started in 1939. RCA's television division, NBC, would be starting regular broadcasts, and the New York World's Fair provided a means of introducing this amazing advancement to millions who would visit their pavilion.
On April 30th, the National Broadcasting Company will begin the first regular public television program service in the history of our country.
Times were hopeful for America. We were finally coming out of the Depression with the help of FDR's administration. Re-election was coming soon, so Roosevelt saw his dedicating the fair as an opportunity for publicity.
I hereby dedicate the World's Fair, the New York World's Fair.
Although only going out to about 150 receivers, RCA was there. It was the first time a political figure had television as an agent of propaganda. But television was off to a slow start. TV sets were too expensive for the poor quality of broadcasting in the early 40s, so popularity dwindled. When America became involved in World War II, networks used their equipment for the promotion of Allied forces in the war effort, and regular programming was suspended. It was not until after the war when the first significant live events were covered by TV. The Democratic Convention of 1948 brought Americans behind the scenes of government. Viewers saw on live TV the troubles of a political party, and were shocked when the right-wing Southern Democrats walked out due to Truman's civil rights platform. Some critics argue that it was this episode that ironically resulted in more votes for Truman. In the early 50s, a young senator from Wisconsin led a series of investigations with the goal of eliminating the threat of communism from the U.S. government. People began to fear this man, for being accused of communist ties by Joe McCarthy usually meant the end of your career and a loss of integrity.
Does this mean I'm a communist, Senator?
That's awfully funny, isn't it, Mr. Secretary? That's terribly funny.
In a 1954 investigative CBS documentary called See It Now, Edward Murrow critically analyzed the legitimacy of McCarthy's accusations and labeled the senator's hearings as witch hunts. It was the beginning of the end for McCarthy.
The actions of the junior senator from Wisconsin have caused alarm and dismay amongst our allies abroad and given considerable comfort to our enemies. And whose fault is that? Not really his. He didn't create this situation of fear. He merely exploited it.
After the documentary was broadcast, a series of events followed that soon brought the junior senator to his demise. A course of hearings were held on live TV to see whether he had abused his power. 20 million Americans were audience for what would be the senator's downfall. McCarthy had wrongfully accused Army Chief Counsel Joseph Welch of harboring a young communist in his law firm. To viewers, Welch became a hero when his rebuttal accused McCarthy of assassinating the boy's character.
Let us not assassinate this lad further, Senator. You've done enough. Have you no sense of decency, sir? At long last, have you left no sense of decency?
For the first time, television had captured the downfall of a political career. Live for all of America to witness for themselves was history in the making. In 1952, the growing power of television was evident. A young Republican candidate for Vice President, Richard Nixon, was accused of accepting illegal funding for his campaign, and it was television which would save his career. In a primetime slot, Nixon, while somewhat avoiding the issue, defended his honor.
I should say this, that Pat doesn't have a mink coat, but she does have a respectable Republican cloth coat. And I always tell her that she'd look good in anything.
Nixon's plea to the American people showed one of the greatest responses in television history. The impact of his speech was obvious. Her presidential candidate, Eisenhower, upon later greeting Nixon, told him, "You're my boy." 1960, from the presidential debates between Kennedy and Nixon, we began to see the increasing importance in the manner in which you present yourself on TV.
Good evening. The television and radio stations of the United States and their affiliated stations are proud to provide facilities for a discussion of issues in the current political campaign by the two major candidates for the presidency.
Before the first debate even started, Kennedy seemed to have the advantages over his opponent. To viewers, Kennedy looked excellent. His suit made him look sharp. Unlike Nixon, he wore a dark one that contrasted with the light background. The parties made a broadcasting agreement to cast a reaction shot of the opposing candidate. Since Nixon had a tendency to perspire when speaking publicly, and he hadn't worn makeup that night, this agreement also fell in Kennedy's favor. In addition, Nixon had to shift his weight periodically due to a recent injury. Consequently, he appeared to be reacting nervously to Kennedy's remarks. The importance of looking good on television was evident, for although the overwhelming majority of those who viewed the debate on TV thought Kennedy had won, an equally vast majority who had listened on the radio thought Nixon had won. But television was an exploding market, and Kennedy was the winner. For Nixon, television, which had earlier been used in his favor, had turned against him now. It's no wonder JFK would become our nation's first TV president.
We shall pay any price, bear any burden, meet any hardship, support any friend, oppose any foe, to assure the survival and the success of liberty.
Television's influence was growing, and TV images left viewers with lasting impressions. By this time, television had become the nation's primary news medium. And when President Kennedy was shot down in Dallas, Texas, it was television which held the nation together.
From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago.
People all over the world were affected by this experience. Never before had an event so drastic been seen by all who had access to a television screen. For 4 days, the world would mourn his death as though they were right there with everybody else. Television was witness to what has become one of the greatest political mysteries of the century, including the murder of JFK's alleged assassin, Lee Harvey Oswald. The entire incident was a watershed moment for TV politics. As the technology advanced, television cameras became increasingly portable and the studios mobile. Networks now had greater capability to go out of the studio on location, and it wasn't long before the people realized that power and attention came to those who caught the camera's eye. What began was a new era in TV politics, one of protest and public demonstration. Using the power of television, a national fight for human rights was finally unifying. For the first time, the rest of America could see firsthand the exploitation of blacks in the South, and the call for civil rights legislation grew immensely. One of the most powerful and moving presentations of the century came in 1963 when a freedom rally was held in Washington, D.C., led by Martin Luther King.
It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream.
Along with King's pledge for nonviolent protest, the peacefulness of the event has been attributed in part to the fact that it was covered by television. Peaceful protests worked at first, but as the number of demonstrations grew, so did the violence. For more than a decade, protesters highlighted nightly news and greatly influenced Americans' reaction to political policy, especially in Vietnam. In the beginning of the war, networks were sent over to display a positive outlook to viewers, but as the war intensified, it became impossible to ignore its negatives. Brought home to TV viewers each night were the devastating realities of combat, which the majority of Americans had never experienced. In 1968, two television reports proved politically damaging to the U.S. war effort. Respected news anchor Walter Cronkite traveled to Vietnam for a second time to analyze the situation in America's position. He returned with a critique that essentially told America that the war was over. We could not win.
The only rational way out then will be to negotiate, not as victors, but as an honorable people who lived up to their pledge to defend democracy and did the best they could. This is Walter Cronkite. Good night.
In January of that year, the Viet Cong launched its Tet Offensive against what was thought to be an impenetrable city, Saigon. Americans saw how close to the U.S. Embassy the enemy had come and were horrified. Due to what they saw on television, public's opinion was swaying. They viewed the war turning for the worst, and the people wanted peace. And in March of 68, television helped cause one more of Vietnam's casualties, Lyndon Johnson.
I shall not seek, and I will not accept, the nomination of my party for another term as your president.
Television was advancing at a fast pace. America's space age was underway, and the U.S. launched a communications satellite to transmit television signals from America to Europe. The benefits of this breakthrough became vastly evident when one-fifth of the world's population watched in July of 1969 as Apollo 11 astronauts Neil Armstrong and Edwin Aldrin became the first to walk on the moon. In the election of 1968, the Vietnam War was a major issue, and Richard Nixon made his comeback, pledging a platform of openness and working toward peace. His victory could be partially attributed to the damaging television publicity at the Democratic Convention in Chicago. Images of police brutality and riot conditions outside the hall were lasting ones. Despite Nixon's pledge, it was not until his second administration that America's involvement in the war was ended. Meanwhile, a scandal was brewing in the Capitol that would prove to be President Nixon's demise. The public viewed on TV the hearings that told of the unethical ways of Nixon's campaign, the Watergate break-in. Nixon election aides were caught red-handed in this building, and at the start of the ordeal, all of them maintained that the president had no knowledge of their actions. As more and more information concerning the Watergate tapes came out, and when one aide testified against Nixon, less and less did the American people trust their president, to the point where it became impossible for Nixon to run the office respectfully.
I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow. Vice President Ford will be sworn in as president at that hour in this office.
Like twice before, the influence of television played a role in the rise and fall of Nixon's career. And now he had been defeated again. This was the 80s. This decade brought television viewers deeper into the political arena than ever before. Along with the increasing viewership in cable TV came the debut of CNN. It was our nation's first 24-hour news program. The importance of its ongoing coverage became apparent in 1986. Since by that year, space shuttle launches had become so frequent, CNN was the only network to carry the Challenger explosion live.
Go and throttle up.
Throughout the 80s, entire political campaigns were geared toward public appeal on television. In 1980, TV's extensive coverage of the American hostages in Iran proved fatal to Jimmy Carter's re-election hopes. As for his opponent, Ronald Reagan, his acting experience allowed him to use television to his advantage. Throughout the decade, rallies were stacked with overzealous supporters, and speeches were written with short one-liners to cast an attractive image through TV coverage.
America will get better and better. Keep hope alive.
Read my lips. No new.
But television campaigns increasingly became geared toward ruining others. Since television allows the impressions of politicians to be so malleable, negative campaigning could ruin a reputation instantly.
Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose.
Senator, you're no Jack Kennedy.
In the election of 88, probably the most influential slashes were between George Bush and Michael Dukakis. Bush aimed his campaign to making national problems appear to be concentrated in Massachusetts. And these images worked.
While on furlough, this man ran away to Maryland, twice raped a woman, and tortured her husband. Now this man is running for president. President? Michael Dukakis, Ted Kennedy's governor.
America saw the demise of many political figures during the late 80s. Televised trials swayed the American opinion in both directions, and the people took a stand. When the Iran-Contra scandal took shape, many people watched Oliver North become a hero to some, a national embarrassment to others. And with the resignation of the Speaker of the House, Jim Wright, we saw how television sees into the private lives of the public figures. But perhaps television is looking too closely at our politicians' lives. Personal matters of today's newsmakers seem to be under the constant scrutiny of the press, with television being used to exploit the faults. What's to come in the future for politics and television? Will the 90s bring the endless search for the perfect politician to an end? Will the public judge by experience and credentials of a candidate, or by the image of his personal life and appearance? Perhaps TV will present just the facts. Then, Americans, by seeing things more clearly, could make better judgments for themselves. As for now, people should be aware how TV can be used to manipulate the way we think. What will this new decade bring? The answer is in television.